challenges and the questions that have arisen as to whether or not he in fact represents anybody in the case, and he has explained that Mr. Bly has filed some sort of petition as a result of the criminal conviction of Mr. Bly. Somehow, I may not entirely correctly characterize things, challenges the representation of Mr. Fallon during the criminal proceeding, and Mr. Fallon is not sure just where he stands. I intend to go ahead with the deposition, and I don't want this dispute between Mr. Bly and Mr. Fallon to interfere with that.
I have a problem. If I undertake a little bit, this is why I'm in the same pickle. What I would like to do, take a moment to see if Mr. Bly would like to discharge him on the record.
We'll do that, and perhaps it'd be easier.
Today, their questions for Mr. Bly, then that I wouldn't be here to direct questions on your behalf. This is your decision. You have to make this decision. So, are you knowing the, what I've explained to you, or are you willing to waive the right to have seen present here in the sentence?
Papers and put on records.
private date I pulled from certain records. I forget the source date. I think it was April 16, 1970.
I believe that's what one of my letters states to my mom and dad from Vietnam.
Did you ever enter a marriage ceremony with her in the United States?
I had kids, a legalized marriage, and that happened December 13th, 1971, in Washington, D.C.
Excuse me. When did Mrs. Bly come to the United States?
I was finally able to bring her in late November. 1971, about the 30th, on or about the 30th. Let me look up. I have kept with people in the air. I don't think it tells me exactly what day she came to. Either the last couple of days of November, the first couple of days of December of 1971.
When were you returned to the United States?
July 4th, 1971.
During the time you were in Vietnam, was Mrs. Bly ever present?
When I first met her in 1961.
Yeah. And I'm not familiar with Vietnamese customs, but she had, you know, use the same last surname too?
No, they keep their maiden name.
What was the last name?
I do not remember. It's been too long since I filled out paperwork on my wife.
Did Mrs. Bly have any brothers and sisters?
At that time, she had one very young brother living in the house. The rest had been married and moved away. Or lived nearby, but...
What was the age of the brother?
I was never certain to that. He was in his lower teens.
Did she have any sisters?
She had quite a few sisters. Most of them lived far away, one lived next door.
What was the name of the one that lived next door? I understand that there's one sister who was alleged to have been connected to the death.
Yeah.
What was the name of that sister?
I think it was me. She had a couple that connected to the economy. I did not find that out until after she came to the United States. From 1975 until 1980, somewhere in 5 years, my wife told me that some person in the world would be a con.
Do you know those sisters' names?
All I know is there were 9 brothers and sisters, including my wife, and I'd only met 2 sisters, and I think 1 or 2 brothers.
Some papers which you furnished here today that refer to pregnancy you described. This is why I had when you first met her and occurred as a result of rape. Do you want to talk
about that? Yeah, when I met my wife and she was pregnant, she was extremely fearful of me. And she told me she had been raped.
Work.
And she cared for
you began staying there 6 days a week. I think you said you finally married her, at least in the Vietnamese ceremony in April 1971. How can you describe how what that up to? How did your relationship with her change from one of sort of staying as a guest at her father's home to marrying
her? We were not intimate at 14 years until a month or two after the marriage. Because she was still extremely careful of that. We had a friendship relationship of love, but not a boy-girl relationship.
Did you and she ever move into a separate house while they were here?
After we got married, my wife had her bed area, instead of being open for everybody to see, surrounded by a tin siding that was about 6 foot high, to enclose just her bed area.
At that time, was the child still living with her?
The child was sleeping with my wife in the same bed. Well, prior to me sleeping in my wife's bed, the child would sleep with her at night.
Living at the same place when you returned to the United States in July 4, 1970.
Yes, sir.
Did you correspond with her after you returned to the United States?
I tried to do the best I could through GIs that I'd met that she could go pick up the mail. I sent money to her for the support of her and what I consider to be my daughter. Also, even though I was not the legal father.
You did consider yourself to be an honor of this child?
I considered myself
the father of this child.
A stepdaughter. I started adoption proceedings of the child with the U.S. Embassy. But they refused to have me legally adopt her until I was legally married in the United States to my wife. That once I brought my wife here and the daughter here, I could finish the adoption papers quickly here by just signing and showing you were married.
After your wife came here and you went to the marriage ceremony with her in Washington, D.C.,
the child was not here, so I did not legally do anything according to immigration.
Do you have any of the papers that you attempted to file with the U.S. Embassy to adopt the child?
The embassy had the only copies of the papers, and when Vietnam fell in 1975, 99% of all the immigration papers that had been filed by everybody was lost at that time.
You have no papers?
Not of the adoption. I only have a few of the papers to bring my wife, her family here. They had lost all of them, including the papers that I was done with her brother.
And what papers do you have that would cover the period between you're leaving the United States, and this is why it's coming to the United States. Can you show me the
papers? Where I went back to the building? to correct one of the threats in his family was in December 1991. You can see that out of his comments.
Let's go through these. Now, you've given me a piece of paper that consists of several pages, and it's marked number 8 in red at the top, and also 9. Is that your marking?
Yeah.
Okay, what's the first page?
It showed, I can't read the name, but it showed that...
Just tell me what the paper is, generally.
My wife signing that she is coming to live with an American, and my address, and her and her daughter.
And what's the second page?
It's another signature that my wife had signed verifying her address and stuff to the authorities in Vietnam.
What's the third page? Marked C.
Another Vietnamese document that tells my wife's name, address, and about her daughter that would also accompany her with all the approval that she would be allowed to come to the United States with her daughter.
And then the fourth page, which is D, is a English translation of the certificate of birth for Joan Hong Nock. Is that correct?
Yes, her daughter.
And sometimes I see these names are arranged in different orders.
In Vietnam, is that their last name for the family name?
And that was Hong.
Hong is another name.
And Nock is first. Is in the certificate of birth, David referred to as being born on September 19, 1970.
The child was born in 1970. It was a misprint that must be the original one with the first translated and not have had to be translated.
Do you have a copy of the original version?
Not with me. I do have the original Vietnamese version.
Can you bring that to me, sir?
30 miles, I would say. All right.
I understand. How long? Papers that you're working on. Well, I hope we'll probably adjourn in one and we'll come back.
How long can it be? How long can it be?
I'd like to see that. Also,
I believe you have a copy of the original birth.
I may have copies, Mr. Blunt, but we need the originals. Can you also explain to me? What you handed me at number marked at the top 31, is that a copy of the birth certificate?
No, that's a copy of approved visa for my daughter. And it has the number at the bottom, 2361, that she would be allowed to come to the United States by the Vietnamese official.
And does that refer to her as being born on 19 September 1970?
Yes. Translations are not for the exact purpose.
Hard to understand how numbers can be misused. Right behind that wall.
Why I came to this country, and I'm not going to go into this country.
that person to take the position with.
It's not the case that the Americans are that you've already
marked them.
Another letter to President Carter, signed and bearing your signature. are the pages number 3, 4, and 5 for the commission?
Newspaper articles that talk about immigration to this country by being a means to Washington Post that was never published.
Your pages 1 and 2.
I'd also send it to Immigration Nationalization Service.
Mr. Chris, where are pages 1 and 2?
They should be in. I have found a lot of my documents were not safely back together properly, and like I said, they.
What is this next page bearing at the top, the name of the Church of the Holy Country?
Oh, that's just about baptismal record, confirmation record, to show that most of my life I've been in church and my family has been in church.
And the next page is something.
That was a letter to the UN High Commission and the president of that office.
Who wrote that letter?
My sister helped me write quite a few of them, but I dictated what I wanted to say, and she would change my wording so it could sound properly, because I've never been able to word stuff properly in my life. I had trouble expressing myself verbally.
They should
all been staying together. that's what he gave. Which has much of the girl's statement presumed all for that. Copies of all five of them where I get them also to my brother-in-law's two children. be financially responsible, so that he would not become on welfare for 3 years.
You don't have anything signed by you that affects that, correct?
No, if everyone who's signed by me is submitted to Bangkok Calling.
Number 9 is an affidavit of Frank Farrow.
Yes, he was the one I complained to about social services neglect of. At that time, I thought my stepdaughter letting her run the streets and refusing to get her any kind of counseling from the Vietnamese indoctrination that my brother-in-law had told me is why she was acting the way she was acting.
Number 11 is handwritten.
My daughter Linda wrote that, and when she was sad one day, and showed it to me a few months later.
Number 12 is labeled Statement of Defendant Bly 1286. Who prepared this?
That was prepared by Officer Robert Bates of the Harris County Police Department, and it was false. My statement to him.
Did you ever tell, what was his name, Bates?
Robert Bates.
Did you ever tell that Mrs. Bly was the child's natural mother? However, the child was told that she was 9 years ago to protect her in the New South Vietnam government. She was told that her mother was dead calm and that she was killed in the war.
My brother-in-law told me the story why she did not like me and my wife when she first arrived in the United States, that she had been told her whole life that story. So when she came up saying she was adopted by us, she was not our daughter, I explained the situation to Officer Bates that she had believed at that time she was not our daughter because I wanted to protect my daughter. I didn't want her to go to jail for a false statement.
I guess I lost that description. When Doc Hong Dong came to this country,
she resented us.
Let me finish the question. Let me try to figure out what I can understand. I will let you assume what I can understand. When Doc Hong Don came to this country, what did your brother-in-law tell you about her parentage?
My brother-in-law told us for her protection in Vietnam, she was given the identity as one of my sister's, my wife's sister's Viet Cong identity to protect her from this new Vietnam communist government because they did not like children whose parents were in America. And they also received a lot of special treatment for her. She had special cards where she wasn't rationed food and stuff. She could get extra food, money from the government. I understood she got a lot of benefits because her mom was a deceased Vietnam, according to the documents that they had done on her at that time.
Did you see those documents?
No.
So what you were told was that Ma Phong Don was raised in the belief that she was not Mrs. Bly's daughter?
Most of her life, yes.
Raised in the belief, at least at the time she came to this country, that she was now Mrs. Bly's daughter.
That's what I understood from her mother.
And let's see. Mrs. Bly left Vietnam in November 1971.
December of 1971, about the 9% of December.
And at that time, any child born January 1970 would have been
almost to, she's been about 21 months.
21, 22 months old. When you were there, the child certainly couldn't speak to us.
She called me daddy, if that's what you mean. She could say a couple of other baby words. I tried to teach her English at the time.
One word.
One word type of thing.
So from the time Mrs. Bly left, or starting at some time when she left, according to Mr. Dunn, Malcolm Dunn was raised, as I said, in the belief that her mother was a Viet Cong person who had died at some point in Vietnam. Is that right?
That was what I was going to beg to believe.
So you, and this is what you told Miss Bates, that this is what she was told, is that right?
Yes. But I also had some blood tests on the girl to see if this was, in fact, not Hong Kong.
Did you ever do blood tests?
They refused. Social services, the courts, and Officer Bates refused to conduct any kind of skin and blood test whatsoever on the girl.
Did you say to Knock Hong Dunn upon, if anything, upon hearing this story from Mr. Dunn?
Well, I heard many stories about Vietnamese indoctrination, other things to explain her reaction in our home. Like the first month she lived in our home, she refused to have me in the same room because I had blue eyes. She was scared to death. I had to stay in another room. She said this would do.
Let me ask a question for you. Did you or Mrs. Bly ever sit down with Doc Hong Dunn and said, hey, this is what Mr. Dunn told us. We don't think it's true. We think you are really Mrs. Bly's daughter.
I've tried to, with my wife, one occasion to talk to the girl, which she did not want to talk to us very frequently, in fact, hardly ever, and explained that my wife was her natural mother. She went into somewhat of a rampage. That's true. Why did you abandon me, etc.? I did not know how to handle it. I went to Father Kamak of my church to try to find out how to handle it. Either we abandoned her, or the story she'd been told most of her life is true. We didn't know what to do. We were trying to deal with the other family problems she was causing first before we were going to deal with that one.
When did you have this conversation?
About 2 weeks after she had come.
When did she come?
The first week of February, about the 7th or 8th of February, 1985.
So she, when you sat down, when you and Mrs. Bly sat down with her and told her that you are Mrs. Bly's daughter.
We did it in the kitchen for you.
Stood up in the kitchen with her and told her you were Mrs. Bly's daughter. She didn't believe it.
She didn't say she didn't believe, but she stated, why did you abandon me then if I'm your daughter?
Did she acknowledge that she was Mrs. Bly's daughter?
No, she did not acknowledge she was not, though.
Did she say anything that would indicate to you that she had ever heard this before, that she was Mrs. Bly's daughter?
She told us that she was told that her mom and dad was in the United States and was shown pictures sometimes, but was told to keep it a secret. from the Vietnam government at that time. Anybody that had a family in America was abused by the government, the communist government of Vietnam. So they kept everything hidden as much as possible from the government. My wife even had to write letters in code to her brother.
What would she write to her brother in code?
He would write code to her and she would reply in code, not naming how much money we were sending so the Vietnam government couldn't find out if they censored all the mail, who to meet, to see, to say hi to. Instead of we're sending you money, go see him and pick it up. Everything was done in kind of a code. We had to ask my wife exactly about the code that her and her brother had formulated over the years.
What did you say, all the mail was censored?
My brother-in-law, until they found out he was trying to come to the United States, was one of the people that censored the mail and packages in Vietnam, was told. And he lived in the Saigon area with his wife and him. I wrote through my wife.
She would write the letters.
Yeah.
How would your wife write to Knock Home Dome as her daughter, if identifying her as her daughter would keep, put Knock Home Dome in some kind of danger because she was here in the United States?
I never went into that with my wife. You have to ask my wife at the teacher's deposition exactly how she had done it. All I would tell, she didn't write exactly 2 miles. She wrote either to Ba or to Oak over there, which is his nickname. And then at the bottom of the letter, she would put a couple paragraphs on it, tell my wife to put on, if you miss her, we're trying to get her here, and et cetera, et cetera, where the father and mother would write to you as well.
When would she ever refer to Knock by name?
Yep.
So whoever reading the letter would know that there was somebody that had been Knock Home Dome in Vietnam, but connected to some people here in the United States,
don't they? I cannot answer what the Vietnamese authorities, if they would find out. According to my brother-in-law, everything was censored over there, so they should have been able to find out. I was not in Vietnam, I do not know that.
Did your brother-in-law or whomever, her sister, go back? Did they ever give you any warnings about referring to it in
the letters? According to my wife, if I remember correctly, they did warn us in code how not to write certain things in the letter.
What books?
I don't remember, it's been so many years now. Like referring to names, the addresses, etc.
A moment ago, you said, did that make you seize referring to Knock by name in any of the letters?
Well, my wife never referred to anybody by their complete legal name in any of the letters. It was just, you're not Kurdish. It means girl by that name in Vietnam. And she referred to him as Oak or Mori, which are his two nicknames. But not his complete given name.
What was your brother-in-law's explanation for that had been given to Knock Home Dome as to what happened to the original child of Mrs. Barr?
he never explained anything in regards to the original child. From 1975 to about 1982, we refused pictures, we did not have any correspondence between that time of any kind regarding Alcette's order. And the only letters we did receive from my brother-in-law stated that she had refused to come to the United States. One day she would want to come, and the next day she refused to come. He probably couldn't get her here.
Did you know that she was being referred to in Vietnam, according to your story, as the child of Mrs. Bly's sister?
At that time, I did not.
You certainly learned that when she came to the United States.
Yeah.
And you talked about it with Mel Fongone, and she said words to the effect that, if I am Mrs. Bly's daughter, why did you abandon me?
Yeah.
What was your answer?
Well, I started to try to answer it. I didn't know exactly how to answer it, but she had stopped out of the room by the time I started talking.
How did Mrs. Bly answer?
Ms. Bly started to say something, I don't remember exactly, but the girl stopped out of the kitchen area.
Did you ever try to talk about the subject of the again?
No, we talked to my brother-in-law in the kitchen. He was also present at this conversation. Whether he knew the truth about Alex or not, because he was very young at the time. And he said he wasn't sure. And when I asked him if he remembered the two sons I had in Vietnam that lived one day and died, he forgot about them. He was young at the time, and he didn't remember very much of anything of when I was actually in Vietnam.
How old was he?
Well, considering we had paid to have his birth certificate altered quite a few times, I don't know how it was done, through the black market, I guess, to keep him from being drafted in the military, which they draft at a very young age, like 14 or 15 a lot of times in Vietnam. I wasn't sure how old he was.
So when you were there, did you know him?
Yeah, I taught him a lot of English.
How old was he in terms of, how old did he appear to be when you were there?
A young teenager, maybe 13 or 14, maybe 15. He rode a Honda very good and got me away from his feet many times. I never had a chance to go to Saigon to do the paperwork, and I rode on the back of his Honda. And he snuck me around the back street to the different agencies to do paperwork. And when the MPs tried to catch us, he was very good on that Honda getting us away.
What was it that he didn't know? I wasn't sure.
Referring to me being in Vietnam?
Referring to not ongoing.
He didn't remember much about my wife giving birth or the birth of two sons or nothing.
Did he remember, where did he live?
With his father while we were there. He'd moved out sometime while we were in the United States to live with the woman who now is his wife. He probably wrote it in his letter. And my wife might remember the day he moved out to live there.
So he didn't know. Did he know whether his sister had died? His sister was alive. Did he know whether she had in fact died?
We received a letter that she came home for a few minutes. Or maybe not a letter, maybe he told her that. She'd come home for a few minutes after the war and to take over and said hi and said the army had told her to go up north someplace and she'd be back in a few days, and they had to go up and pick up her father, and she was poisoned by the new government. They executed everybody. There would be a time because they didn't want them fighting the North Vietnamese to take over, and they executed most of my other white family who worked for the South Vietnamese army or government, like her brother-in-law and other people.
I'm sorry, where did you learn that she had been killed? Where and from whom?
I don't remember if it was from a letter. I remember the girl saying it during the trial that her mother had come home, that had visited for a couple minutes while she was asleep. She was told to go up north someplace for a couple of days to do something. And the next time she saw what she thought was her mother, she was dead.
I think we may have a letter related to that. Would that refresh your recollection, or if it's in Vietnamese, would that not be helpful?
It would not be helpful. We received literally 1,000 letters from Vietnam relating to so many things, and I'm not able to read Vietnamese. My wife is translating the letters to me. And between 75 and 1978, I, a lot of times, hid the letters from my wife and let her girlfriends read it. Because my wife would break up in tears and couldn't go to work for 2 weeks because another relative had died. I tried to gently break it to my wife. We got another letter that her father had died, her brother had died, her brother-in-law had died, her sister had died. Every other letter was this way for 2 to 3 years, and it really upset my wife.
But you did learn that her sister had died and had come to visit Nault.
But Nault was asleep. Wow.
And you think you learned that when Nault was still in Vietnam?
I heard it again in the trial. Not stated that her mom had come to visit her and she was asleep and he didn't wake her up.
You heard it once in trial, but you heard it once by letter from Vietnam.
Either when he lived in my house or by letter from Vietnam, I don't remember.
Did you ever have any other conversations with Nock about his parentage after the incident?
I personally did not talk to Nock very often. As I stated, the first month I had been in different rooms because I had blue eyes. She found things throughout the 10 months she lived in my house to keep me and my children away from her, and most of the time to keep my wife away from her and my sister-in-law, who stayed together. My wife, I believe, did talk to her a couple of times about her parentage, but I'm not positive about that. Or
did you discuss that with your wife?
Yes, after the kitchen incident, I discussed with my wife, what would we say? Would we let her keep going on the opinion she was adopted for a while until she learned to love us and be part of our family, and then we could tell her the truth so she wouldn't resent us from leaving her behind in Vietnam? What would we do? And we never did come up with a decision of exactly how we would handle this.
Now, she arrived in February 1985. Correct. We had this conversation with her 2 weeks later, correct?
Yes.
And at the same time, you had a conversation with Mr. Dunn, who was present at the conversation, not long ago.
Yes.
Did you ever have any other conversations with Mr. Doan concerning her parentage?
I might have.
Did you ever have any conversations with his wife?
I talked to his wife a lot because she was interested in learning English. But it was mainly teaching her English. But I did tell a lot about that to her to try to make her understand the English word she was trying to learn in English school. Giving examples of stuff like table or...
Teach her English, I'm asking about conversation, but I'm not holding all this crap.
I think I did tell her she was my wife, Madison Bruno. I don't remember if I told her during the...
Of course, she ever tell you what the relationship was.
We never discussed about that much. For the first couple of months, it was mainly, instead of teaching English the boring way, we tried to have conversations about family in Vietnam and family here, to relate to English words so she could put them into sentences. Because she did not go to work for the first 3 months she was in my home, and that's the work record right here.
We'll make this Mark number 12, exhibit 12. Next item is mark number 14, and you say that's a work record of any line?
The first page is the work record for the years between December of 1984 and December of 1985. Is their calendar year. I've yet to get the one for December 85 through December 86.
And just briefly, what are the rest of the pages?
First off, showing that I was quite busy in my store that day. That page made my wife remember that the girl was not even home the date I was supposed to molest her. My wife gave me the exact thing, which made me remember. And on the 15th, when she was awarded her degree for driving, she had to make up 3 additional hours of driving in order to get that degree. She was in class for a final test for 3 hours that morning. And the minute she got home, our family, which is me, my wife, 3 children, and her, went out to dinner to celebrate. She had completed driver's ed that day, so there was not 1 minute I was alone with her July 15th. But of course, we didn't put on a defense in court, so none of the documents got submitted to court. And when the state asked for alibis, I didn't need an alibi. The girl wasn't at home.
The next item is, first of all, we'll make the package mark number 14. The next item is mark number 16, and that appears to be transcript of proceedings before the Master of Juvenile Causes in Yarn County, is that right?
Yeah.
Exhibit 16. Next is mark 18. Just tell me briefly again what that is.
The list of alibis for July 15th, which is here at that other page. The secretary must staple all of these receipts from my business to the other thing instead of to the back of that.
Back number 18, exhibit 18. Number 20 is a certificate of marriage for you and Mrs. Bly, 15 December 1971.
You requested that I bring the proof of mine and my wife's marriage.
Exhibit 20. Number 21 is marked the top last will and testament. Is that your current last will and testament?
No, it is not. That was one that I filled out, giving my wife and children everything that I owned in a will. It's by PTO to supply and fill in the blanks.
Why was this filled out?
At the time, I felt that I'd be going to jail the rest of my life, and I would hang myself in jail if I ever went there.
Well, when did you first come to believe that alcoholism was not Mrs. Bly's?
When January 1st, 1986, we called her out to my store, me and my wife did. And we told her about the police officer Bates, that he had commanded that we bring her to the police station the next night after school, and that we would have to go, and I'm sorry she would have to go there. She refused to go. She stated that she wanted to go live with her brother and her uncle. She refused to go to the police. She then changed her story, said she had family in Colombia, a Vietnamese family, that would let her drive, she wouldn't have to go to school. Then she laughed at us, saying, "I'm not even your daughter, no. Ha, ha, ha." And she stamped out of my store back into the house. I thought she was mad at us at that time because I was, at that time, kicking her out with my brother-in-law and sister-in-law. I applied for Section 8 housing in Laurel for them, where they could both maintain their job. And I also offered my brother-in-law child support for her to take care of her, but since she resented my family so much, and she loved her, what I thought at that time, her Aunt Min, I felt it best for her to move out with her aunt and uncle, and I would pay support. I thought she was as mad when she laughed at us that she was not really out of order. But it kind of brought in some suspicions in my mind. All of the resentment we had for the 10 months she'd lived in our home. She never wanted to talk to us about anything in Vietnam, any of the relatives. She kind of hid all of the family facts. She stayed with Min almost 24 hours a day when Min was home from work.
Did she say anything else to you at that time that made you think that she was not Mrs. Wise's natural daughter?
No, just that she was not known.
Next is what I'm going to describe as a letter, but I don't really know what it is. It's mark number 22, and it appears to be in Vietnamese. Can you tell me what that is?
It's a letter from one of my sister-in-law's in Vietnam.
What's the date of that?
No, there's a print I have in the This is from my sister-in-law.
The second page of 22 is from your sister-in-law.
That's a girlfriend. That's Sal. That's a letter from Sal, my sister-in-law.
This is
the letter. I don't understand the reason why I put this in it. There should be some reason. My wife told me it would be good for evidence. I don't read Vietnamese, so...
Do I understand the same person wrote both these pages?
My wife says she thinks that both of them were written by Sal. And she noticed my name is present. It was something to do with me, but she'd have to get my wife to interpret it.
Page number 22. Exhibit 22. Number 23 is a letter from the Assistant Attorney General to your attorney, dated January 29, 1987. Is that correct?
Yes.
That's number 24.
To get daughter 1 week before the fall of Vietnam in 1975, I was also on an airplane and had purchased tickets and had a foreign passport to go to Vietnam to get my brother-in-law and my stepdaughter. But just as we were boarding the airplane, it came over the loudspeaker that South Vietnam had fallen, so I got back off and cashed in the tickets. my brother-in-law had called me for 3 weeks prior to all of Vietnam, begging for help at the embassy. Wouldn't let him out. Something wasn't right to pay for. Some number was wrong. Some day the first or something was wrong.
Number 27 appears to be court papers for the district court against Tin Tai Dong.
That was his drunk driving conviction.
Nobody believed that, right?
27.
Your brother dog, I'm
number 28 is
my alibi.
We're all in law case, the district court, to get in the papers, we're in law drunk driving.
Well, the state's attorney said on or about July 5th.
He went to work.
The court started in 12 months.
My girlfriend started going up the front door.
The 16th, 17th, and 18th. I got all my business tickets to refresh my memory of what I would be doing that day.
And he also had something similar. I told the girlfriends about the syphilis. They quit them instantly.
Psychological evaluation.
And his wife both had syphilis, active syphilis. I had to pay a fortune to get treated when they first came here. And active TB. And a very deadly stomach virus.
She, my wife.
That if not treated, could kill you. And immigration first did you a health check before they came?
What's the significance of this cutting special?
It had backed up. I didn't have a social service person who I was going to sue in Bahia Falls, so I found out she was not Hong Kong. I asked for counseling before this girl several times, master's hearings several times on the phone to Officer Bates, Mike Marshall, Frank Farrow, Governor Hughes at that time, I think it was. That social services were saying this girl's under wild party, drinking, having boyfriends in their mid-20s, which she confessed at trial. Unsupervised, and not a minute of counseling, which she also testified at trial.
When you had this, who had this psychological evaluation? Okay?
When I threatened Mike Marshall at a hearing to have him removed from the case April 28, 1986, for neglecting the child, he ran out and immediately got this, which the court had ordered twice previously. That's why the juvenile transfer.
And this, what you're saying is that this evaluation was obtained basically at your request.
I should have given up. You're
no, I was requesting counseling, not an evaluation. So the truth could be found out of the allegations against you.
The internet.
Why did you have it, because you wanted to help?
No, I wanted her to get counseling because my brother-in-law kept telling me it was the Vietnamese indoctrination of her, the communist indoctrination is the way she acted. In fact, he wrote a letter on my behalf.
So at the time of this evaluation, you still believe she was your daughter, is that correct?
Yes.
You still believe she was my Mrs. Bly's natural daughter at the time of this evaluation in May 1986?
Yes. Mm-hmm. There's a second evaluation there, too. The second evaluation was after my conviction, because I did not put on defense at my trial, I put in a contempt order and a neglect charges against Michael Marshall, because I was guilty of child abuse and he was guilty of child neglect, not giving the girl 1 minute of counseling that she had testified to in court. And he was guiltier than I was because he was an official. He ran out and got her another evaluation, which also recommended counseling, which he still refused to do.
Exhibit 29.
your second evaluation says her mom is alive in Vietnam with a heart problem, and she misses her sisters and brothers in Vietnam. That was the final blow that told me my daughter was dead in 75 by the other circumstantial evidence. Right on the bottom there, Ray. I think I got the circle there, right there.
Well, once you have circle, what? Once you have circle, says that. Yearns to return to Vietnam, where she believes her biological mother is living.
She goes on to say she misses her mom, who has a heart problem in Vietnam.
Let me ask a question. Do I recall that you had said she had told you previously that Mrs. Bly's sister had come saw her briefly, and she had last seen this sister when she was dead?
The sister came to the house while she was asleep, and she did not see her. The sister had to leave for a couple of days to go up on some mission for the new Vietnam government and return dead. They had to go take her body up. And they believed, my brother-in-law believed, that she had been poisoned by the new regime.
How did she believe? I don't understand. How could she believe her biological mother is living if she saw this sister dead?
That just killed my brother-in-law's story that her mother was a Viet Cong, because if her mother is still alive and she has brothers and sisters she misses in Vietnam, and the story that I was originally told in my house, what she was told in Vietnam, was false. She has not any relationship to our family whatsoever.
How would she know whether she really is or not?
If she knows her mother has a heart problem in Vietnam, she knows it. And it states right in there.
What were the names of your parents?
Catherine, Elizabeth Bly, and Curtis Austin Bly.
How do you know that they are your parents other than what you've been told?
Because I knew the two doctors that delivered me that they named me after, Raymond and Yeager.
How did your father know he was the son of his parents other than what he was told?
Good question. How do any of you really know it? I look identical to my father, which looks identical to his father. And that's a good thing to see. But not on Don, as well as my three children. Let me rephrase that. My three children born here in the United States look like my relatives, but not like my wife. We figured Nap Tong Don would look like her father, not my wife also, since the male genes and my wife seems to always come out the male genes. Some children look like mothers, some children look like fathers, some children don't look like anybody. The three American children look like my side of the family. In fact, my oldest daughter, Linda, you take a teenage picture of my sister, Margaret, you can't tell them apart.
Well, just for curiosity's sake, who did you think knocked on the door?
Probably her father. Whoever he was.
You've never seen her father. This is why I've never seen her father since the rape.
That's correct.
We'll make this number 29, exhibit 29. Number 30 appears to be some medical reference for Dr. Holmdahl. What's this?
That's a complete school reference.
Everybody uses
Number 32 is a letter. I think it's a letter.
It's a letter and a very poor translation of the letter. I paid $100 for that translation. Whenever you use me when you write that letter, and don't ever show anybody that translation. It's totally inaccurate.
The letter is dated January 18, 1986. Who's it addressed to?
To anybody I would want to give it to help me out in the allegations that were lodged against me by the girl and was written by my brother-in-law at his own free will to help him.
I'm sorry, who signed the letter? Your brother-in-law.
He wrote it and signed it.
Wrote it this way.
In fact, for the months he lived now, I was out of bed over in the closet room, constantly calling me my wife. About the girl lying, that he didn't believe her, that he was sorry that he brought her, making us this much trouble, and that he wanted to help us. In fact, he even went to one of my lawyers, the very first one after I was arrested, to get evidence to help me against the girl.
Number 36 is a letter to Mr. McMillan from Bruce A. Beardsley, Counselor of Embassy. Is that
Yes, it is.
That exists. Okay. Number 37 is a letter from Joyce M. Boyd to you, dated June 3, 1985. Is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
What's the significance of that?
Well, that letter previous that you just changed says that everybody is totally checked. Nobody comes here with contagious TB or contagious deadly intestinal parasites before they're treated. That there's no way they could get through the system, et cetera, et cetera. The second letter named that my brother-in-law had contagious TB. We had a two-bedroom house using one bathroom, one kitchen, one dining room. And he had highly contagious TB, which we did not find out for 4 months. We're still being tested every 6 months to make sure we don't, me and my children don't come up with TB. They also cost me about $200 in medicine because the health department was not supplying the medicine. On the contagious intestinal parasite, it is from some kind of Asian strain. They're very deadly if not treated. And that letter was also asking for proof of the identity of this girl to see if they could possibly get somehow into Vietnam and find if my daughter was deceased or in fact this was the girl. And they could not actually answer it.
So as of July 10, 1987, you still didn't know whether or not Holmdahl was Mrs. Bly's daughter or some other person.
That's correct.
Right.
I had my doubts.
You had doubts. But you really didn't know. You didn't know. And number 37, again, is a letter dated June 3, 1985, from Dr. Boyd and Mr. Bly. You told him in 1985, anyhow, that he was his wife's daughter, something like that. 38.
You keep referring to stuff. Na Pong Don is the actual daughter of my wife.
38 is what?
Welfare fraud. My brother-in-law and sister-in-law, they went to welfare 2 days before Min quit her job, stating she did not have a job. She made false allegations against me and my family at that time. They refused public Section 8 housing, low-income housing in rural, to go to Columbia, so she just quit. And also, like an idiot, my brother-in-law came over and asked me how to withdraw the last $1,600 out of his account so welfare wouldn't catch him in his account. And I told him how to go write a check, and he could get the rest of his money out of his account.
This doesn't have anything to do with Mark Hong.
Well, it shows the whole conspiracy to back up Kim's testimony that my sister-in-law had laughed at a party and had told her secretly that we've all pre-planned that he could all get out on their own and get welfare, free housing, etc. It shows,
where does it show that?